This video is sponsored by Factor. Denmark has been making waves recently because of their plans to build an epic energy island in the North Sea, a mega project that's colossal both in ambition and scale. But Denmark historically has been a major oil producer. Plus, we already have offshore wind turbines. So why is Denmark really building this? And does it even make any sense? Let's dive in. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. When it comes to global carbon footprints, Denmark is hardly one of the major offenders. A country of just 6 million people, the nation has already invested in cutting their emissions in half over the last few decades. The Danish parliament has issued a near-total ban on companies receiving new licenses to hunt for and extract oil, and will phase out all natural and gas exploration contracts in the North Sea by 2050. This is a bold choice because, as we mentioned, Denmark is a pretty major oil producer. In fact, they're number 6 in all of Europe. But to put that into context, they're number 49 around the world, and their production of around 64,000 barrels a day pales in comparison to the big boys, like Saudi Arabia, who produces 145 times more, Russia 158, and the US producing 174 times as much oil as Denmark each day. So it's not a massive amount, but the move to end oil and gas contracts by 2050 is estimated to cost Denmark about $2.1 billion in revenue yearly. So it is still quite a bold move for an oil-rich country to make this move. So why do it? The initiative is already set to be the largest construction project in Denmark's history. But instead of investing in railways or roads, the nation is investing in this, the Energy Island. An island that will be at least 120,000 square meters. That's about the size of 22 American football fields. And that's just the preliminary plans. Eventually, they hope to expand the island to 3 times of that size. The island will either be made of watertight caissons placed on the seabed and surrounded by a seawall, or it'll be built up with sand as an artificial island. While the exact location is still being kept under wraps, it'll likely be built about 50 miles off the coast of Thornsmead, west of the Jutland Peninsula in the North Sea. So, why are they building an enormous island in the middle of the ocean? Well, the idea is for the island to act as a power hub, essentially a green power plant. See, the facilities of the island will be connected to over 200 giant offshore wind turbines, each approximately 850 feet tall, around 3 times the size of the Statue of Liberty. All this wind fuel will give the site an energy capacity of between 3 and 5 gigawatts, enough to power about 5 million households, about double the number of homes currently in Denmark. But again, that's just the beginning. Eventually, the plan is to expand to 600 turbines for a total capacity of roughly 10 gigawatts, enough to power 10 million homes. But wait, there's more. A second island in the Baltic Sea is also being planned, though this one is being built on an already existing island of Bornholm. Their facility will provide an additional 2 gigawatts of energy. My first question would be, why not focus on the already existing island project first? But I digress. That means when these projects reach their full intended capacity, they'll produce a whopping 12 gigawatts of energy, equivalent to the entire current offshore wind capacity for all of Europe. If the plant produces energy just 12 hours a day, that's 144 gigawatt hours per day, or 53 terawatt hours a year. Denmark's entire yearly usage is just 33 terawatt hours, meaning they can sell the remaining 20 or so. More on that in just a little bit. But the plans go even further. Eventually, the goal is for the island to house energy storage equipment for when energy supply exceeds demand. Out in the ocean, the developers also hope to use the site to convert wind energy into other types of green fuel, like hydrogen, to act as a docking site for shipping, aviation, and heavy industry. Speaking of refueling, is a perfect segue to our sponsor this week, Factor. Let me let you in on a little secret. This channel is like running 2 full-time jobs, plus I have a family and 2 young boys, so one thing I obsess about is time management. Factor is the home delivery meal service that ships delicious, healthy food to your door that you can prepare in minutes. Factor's team of registered dietitians prepare amazing meals from scratch. Honestly, it's like eating home-cooked meals without the hours of grocery shopping, cooking, and cleaning up afterwards. With options like keto, calorie smart, chef's choice, veggie, and vegan options, and a menu that updates weekly and has over 27 meals and 33 add-on options, This is a must-have service for our family. I can't even tell you how many hours a week Factor saves us. Plus, the price per meal saves us money, too. You can pick from meals each week or sit back and let Factor pick. And you can always add more meals or take a week off if you're traveling. If you want to eat healthier, save money, and free up time for your family or hobbies or a side hustle, head to go.factor75.com/2bit130 and use code 2bit130 to get $130 off across 6 boxes. Great deal, great company. Thanks to Factor and you for supporting the show. The exact specifications of the island, though, have yet to be finalized. While the project will be funded largely by government funding, private companies will also have an opportunity to invest and have a say in the island's development. One company, the Vin Consortium, has bid to include thermal energy storage, data centers, and accommodations for site workers, visitors, and researchers, with flexibility in mind, collecting and distributing power around the shared grid as demand dictates. Now, this is all great and all, but it doesn't really answer the question of why build an island. We have offshore wind turbines today. We have energy storage on land, and we can produce hydrogen and other fuels anywhere and pipe it to ports. What makes this so important? For one, yes, we do have offshore wind turbines today, but there's a catch. As we discussed in our video on offshore wind turbines, which we'll link here, the highest wind speeds are on the deep waters farther out at sea. But traditional wind turbines are typically limited to about 50 meters of sea depth because of the steel monopiles that have to be driven into the sea floor to support their massive size. So depending on the specifics of their energy island, it's possible to position wind turbines in new ways that aren't possible today. And consider this, we in California are in a pretty serious drought. So there was a vote to build a new $1.4 billion desalination plant in the Southern California city of Huntington Beach, about 30 miles south of Los Angeles. And in a great victory and in a moment of tribute to the efficacy of government, it passed and soon we'll have covered all of our freshwater problems. No, I'm kidding. The California Coastal Commission voted 11-0 to reject the proposal by Poseidon Water. Here's the thing, with every great ambition or project, there comes a need for regulators and approvals. Sometimes the great challenges of our planet aren't held up by the brilliance of scientists or engineers. It's regulators and politicians. Look, I'm not trying to make this a thing. There are environmental challenges with desalination, like the leftover brine, all of which I covered in this video, which you can check out in the show notes. By building a dedicated energy island, I believe Denmark can be much more nimble with future projects. No one wants to see beautiful ocean coastlines marred with the sight of wind turbines. But if they were all built in dedicated regions for just this purpose, you wouldn't even be able to see them. Plus, there's a major sense of not in my backyard, where people often vote down projects like this if they deem it too close to home. It's all pretty understandable, and I think Denmark might be paving the way to thinking about producing energy going forward. It's like when my kids ask me if they can have a candy, and then a toy, and then go out and play. I'm less likely to say yes with each new request. But if they had instead just asked me if we can go to SeaWorld, odds are they'd get all three. But there's another question. Why is such a small country planning to produce so much power? Especially a country that, as we mentioned, already has such a relatively small footprint. After all, Denmark already gets about 52% of its energy from renewable sources. The truth is, this project isn't meant just for Danes. See, the hubs will route power via underwater cables, not just to Denmark itself, but to neighboring nations. While the specific countries have yet to be named, according to Professor Jacob Ostergaard of the Technical University of Denmark, countries like the UK and Germany could benefit. Now, this ambitious project comes with a hefty price tag, about 210 billion kroner, or about $34 billion US. For decades, Denmark has been a climate leader in the EU, while countries like Germany and the Netherlands and Belgium have developed their own strong wind sectors. Denmark was the first to build offshore wind farms nearly 30 years ago. The current price of electricity in Denmark is around 35 euro cents, or about 40 cents US. As we mentioned earlier, at max capacity, the two islands combined would produce 20 terawatt hours more than the annual power consumption of the entire country. If the Danes sold energy at just 6 cents per kilowatt hour, they would make nearly $3.2 billion US per year. Of that, $1.2 billion would be excess energy that they would export to other countries. But in Europe, where stricter and stricter carbon reduction efforts are taking effect, they could probably sell that energy for twice as much and make over $6.4 billion in revenue, while still being zero carbon and likely cheaper than alternative forms of energy. This also means that the entire project could pay for itself in between 5 and 10 years. Not bad. Plus, by having an entire island dedicated to the production and proliferation of energy, we might see all sorts of technologies take hold, like the Finnish sand battery we talked about in this video, or CO2 batteries, or cryogenic air battery storage. If the island was producing a ton of net energy when demand was low, they could power large-scale hydrogen generation via electrolysis, or desalination, and then make even more money selling those products to cargo ships or to consumers. Honestly, the island is a giant renewable energy playground, and the options are pretty much limitless. Over the last few years, we've seen just how much of a vice grip oil-producing countries like Russia can have over Europe. In 2021, two-fifths of the gas Europeans burned, and over a quarter of the EU's imported crude oil comes from Russia. Making renewable source like wind cheaper and more reliable could help many countries in the EU wean off of Russian dependency and create more autonomy and independence. While the two energy islands will not completely fix this problem, they can provide a crucial step. Plus, if proven successful, this project could inspire other nations to make these kinds of bold investments not only in themselves, but around the globe and the global community. One question, though, that still comes to mind is, artificial islands? Doesn't that kind of sound a little Lex Luthor? What kind of impact could this project have on sea life and other underwater ecosystems? Fortunately, this is something the developers of the project are already considering. Right now, various research projects are underway, studying everything from soil quality to environmental impact to try to reduce as much harm as possible. Danish organization EnergyNet is conducting preliminary studies on the seabed around both Bornholm and the region in the North Sea where the artificial island will go. The goal of these studies is to ensure that both the island and the wind turbines are placed in areas best suited for construction while also leaving the smallest environmental footprint. Plus, even beyond the energy island, if this proves successful, we could decentralize energy generation and set up artificial islands in areas with minimal impact to wildlife. It just comes down to planning and risk management. Still, when we think about how these projects will impact sea life and ecosystems, it's important to consider them in the larger conversation of climate change. While these projects will almost certainly have some impact on the environment, nothing could be more detrimental to our oceans than continuing to burn stuff at the rate we are today. Right now, to meet its climate goals, the EU needs to implement a total of 300 gigawatts of combined offshore wind by 2050, around 25 times higher than where it is currently. Denmark's Energy Island, when complete, will at least double current offshore wind production. While there is still a few unknown variables, this project seems to be a major step in the future, not only for the EU, but for the developing nations throughout the world. So that is a look at Denmark's new insane Energy Island megaproject, and why I think it's pretty smart. Let's identify one single place to do all of our clean energy operations and generation, rather than a dozen smaller projects that each need soil sampling and studies and approvals. Perhaps a megaproject like this is exactly what we need to make other really promising technologies possible, like this one.